I'm Marshalette Wise, the founding director of Wise Scholars Foundation. Wise Scholars Foundation is a 501c3 nonprofit organization with a mission of assisting socioeconomically disadvantaged and at-risk youth with school completion and college recruitment. Founded in 2005, my vision has grown into establishing Wise Scholars Academy. Wise Scholars Academy will serve as a public boarding school as I go forward with my dream of opening up my own school. I reflected back to all the greats who had done it before. I researched Mary McLeod Bethune, Charlotte Hawkins Brown, and Nanny Helen Burroughs. And then I thought of my great-great-aunt, Mary Hines Johnson, who also started her own school in 1940 in Franklin, Georgia. But I have to admit, I really didn't know much about Mary Hines Johnson. So I decided the best thing to do was to travel to Franklin, Georgia, to the community that she served and ask them, who is Mary Hines Johnson?
Mary Hines Johnson? I don't know, darling.
I don't know. I don't see her in my life.
I do not know her.
I don't even know. I have no idea.
I don't know.
Mary Hines Johnson. I don't know who Mary Hines Johnson is.
Not sure. Can't answer that. I don't know the answer to that.
However, among the many who did not know who Mary Hines Johnson was, I found a few, like me, who had heard a little about her.
Well, I really don't know. I started school in 1968. Went to school at Hill Mary Johnson then. Went there 1 year, next year was integrated. That's all I really know.
A good woman in the community to help the kids further their education. I hear a lot of people talking about her.
But she bought built school and you know, saying a lot from black for winter school.
The one that worked up there, ran that school house up there, Prairie Elementary School.
She founded the first black school around here. It used to be called Mary Johnson High.
This made me curious and want to learn more. So I gathered up a film crew and they traveled with me to Franklin, Georgia to seek out the people who knew, worked with, were taught by, and who just sincerely loved Mary Hines Johnson. And this is what we found.
Tell me, how did you come to know Mary Hines Johnson?
Listen to my mother talk back when I was a little young boy. You know, they talked about Mary Johnson, you know, like she was a mother figure to the whole community. And she got out and she decided one day that I'm gonna take care of these kids, make sure they get an education. So the story that I heard from Miss Mary Johnson about her from my mother was years ago she was walking from the Noon Highway coming into Franklin. It came up a big thunderstorm, big cloud, raining. And she had little kids with her. And she got all the little kids and went and took them up on the bridge. And Miami now when thunder and lightning, you know, kids afraid of the rain and thunder and lightning back then like that.
They sought shelter under this river bridge. As she was sitting there and the children had quieted down and the thunder and the lightning was flashing and she was watching the inhabitants of the river rush to their individual places to go for shelter. She said, if tadpole, the fish, this, they had a place to go of their own. Why couldn't the colored children of her county have their own school?
So they all got up on the bridge, and I was told that Mary Johnson said a prayer. A prayer so silent but so loud that I believe God really heard, and that's what they say. And she comes from on that bridge, and she gathered the people, the community together, and built a school for the black people to go to.
Nora, all my life, I was young. She didn't work in the community where she lived. She was down in Franklin, and she was working down there, and she would come over every morning, walk through the pasture to our house to catch a ride down to Franklin to go to school. At that time, mail delivered, he would bring the mail from Carrollton down to Franklin, and she would catch him every morning. It'd be raining, ice, whatever the weather. She had to walk through the woods to our house, and she would stay there till the ride came. Then she'd come down to Franklin. Then she'd get out there at Franklin, and she had to walk about a mile this time to the school.
I read a high-interest story about Mrs. Mary Johnson in 1951 when I was in grad school at Atlanta University. Mr. Felton J. Rasmussen, the principal of that school, came to me and said, I need a teacher. I told him I didn't plan to teach because I was in the School of Political Science, planning to go into law. And I said, I'd like to meet Mrs. Mary Johnson. And what I did, I put my belongings in the trunk of his car. And he went home, I went home, came back and lived on his porch while I commuted from Hogansville to Franklin as a teacher. And that was my beginning. I taught all subjects, social studies, physics, chemistry, math, because they had never had a class to graduate for blacks in Hurd County. If you was a Negro, you had to go somewhere else to get a high school diploma. So I was the sponsor of the senior class as well as the junior class. The first prom, the first graduating class, all of that came about my first year in education. I worked there for a year and a half, got drafted in the Korean conflict, and came back in 1956. In 56, I came back and laid brick for 8 months and started back teaching at Mary Johnson High School.
Well, I knew her from my business and for her, working for education and all of that, and trying to better things. But I remember building that school. I think she was a wonderful educator, and I think she did all she could towards education.
Mary Elizabeth Hines was born in Glynn, Georgia on March 23, 1895. In 1896, the Supreme Court held that separate but equal facilities did not violate the 14th Amendment. They concluded that children of former slaves would be best served by attending schools in their own communities. Educational facilities remained separate, but they were not equal.
But during the time that she struggled so and so hard, she was very much concerned about education of black people. She would give her life to educate the black people. And things were so unbalanced for the blacks and the whites in the county. Even at one time, the blacks had buses. They were transported by buses. The black did not.
Well, I remember that we was, being hungry and cold. She would bring food from home to feed us. She would make us tea. Because if you are not full, if your stomach is not full, it's hard to learn. In a way, Mary Hines Johnson was the first person to start the free lunch program.
Did have lunch room. bring a sandwich, bring a biscuit. Cold, you know, it'd be cold, during the winter it's cold, you'd eat whatever it was, it's cold. But thank God we made it. But I thank God that God will have somebody to lead his people. Yahweh, I'll use this word, Yahweh has a ram in the bush. And I think she was a ram at that time for the black people for his education. Especially for this county. Yeah, she done a lot.
What wasn't so beautiful was not having the proper materials during our time. But the teachers did what they could with that, with the materials they had.
I'm sure I didn't have a paper and pencil. So Miss Johnson used it with bringing all of the paper and pencil. Even I remember oatmeal box. She would say oatmeal box and bring it so we could make a basket.
And the awful thing, you know, I was telling some kids not long ago, when I was in school, even when I graduated from Mary Johnson, all of my books have, now we got a book, it had all kind of names in it. I didn't ever get a new book. Never had a new book. We got hand down. The new books went to high school. And we got what they had. They'd be raggedness. But you know, through all of that, we accomplished a lot. A lot of them got education. Some of them couldn't even read. They probably would never been able to read if they hadn't had this opportunity to get some book, but even though they were raggedy. But they were usable, and they used them.
At that time, you just didn't have any emphasis on black education in the smaller communities. Most people had to either go to Atlanta or some larger community to finish high school. They just didn't have schools beyond the sixth grade level for blacks in a lot of communities. I recall I went to a Bolden high school. In fact, all of my siblings went off to a Bolden school after maybe ninth grade. And when I went to college, I was the first in my family to finish, first boy in the family to finish a college myself. And that was in 47. In fact, when I went to school, I had full scholarships, full tuition scholarships. I had scholarship to Payne College, to Hampton, to Georgia State, which is my name, Savannah State, and Fort Valley State. I didn't know about any colleges, so I had seen Fort Valley doing construction work. That scholarship was worth $20 per quarter, $60. So you can just see, we're talking about ancient versus today.
Like many blacks at the time, Mary began her teaching career at church. The Ebenezer Church became her classroom. Its one room could hold no more than 40 students. This was the church Mary was leaving when a storm forced her and her students to find shelter under a bridge.
Grandma married Grandpa, and she started teaching at the age of 14, and she taught out of the Ebenezer Baptist Church. We used to call it the Ebenezer School. And Grandma would meet other women from the community. They would all meet Grandma at this fork of the road, and Grandma would take the children and walk them to Ebenezer.
Aunt Mary? Yeah, I went to school. Aunt Mary. Ebenezer Church. I think it was in the 40s. Black kids, there wasn't too many here. Some of them went. I went, but I didn't go that much. She taught school at a house. And then she left and went to Ebenezer. We had to walk from up on where the Hood High School is now. We walked from there to Ebenezer, the school.
At the beginning, she would have a school in the church, Ebenezer Baptist Church. And they had been doing it for some time, and so she wanted to have a school. She wanted to get out of the church badly. It was told that she would take her paycheck and buy material and stuff for the new building that she was working to build. And she had suppers and fundraisers, bake sales, and shows she put on to raise money. It was a hard time when people didn't have money. Most of the people were farmers. And her husband named Johnny. Johnny Johnson was a farmer. He farmed while she taught school. And so after she had enough money to get the project started, and it got to build one of the little pictures I showed you a while ago. That was the little building, one room. And it was precious at that time.
Mary Johnson's original one-room wooden schoolhouse was located on Highway 34 East toward Noonan. To fund its construction, she paid by giving every penny of her $28 monthly salary.
In the beginning, she didn't say she was building the school, but that dream developed, and she found a way to get a piece of land. No county money was given to the blacks back then because they didn't believe blacks needed schools. But Grandma was determined to find a way. So somehow she came up with $50 and she talked this contractor, would he build the one-room school for her. He decided to do it for $500. So she gave $50 down and had told him when she got paid from the county, she would turn her monthly check over to them. So thus, that's the Brown Schoolhouse.
The place where she built her first building, up 34, Fort Newman. Over to the right, you had the schools, and you had the buildings, and then across the street there, you had a little flat land that you played basketball, and you had recess people went and so forth. So that was where it was.
When you went to school, you was with different age children. You know, they were not all like sixth graders, kindergarten, 6-year-old, and the 7 years old, and kindergarten, 5-year-old. All I remember, we just all together learning our 3 hours, reading, writing, and arithmetic.
After World War II, Army barracks were torn down and donated to poor areas. These former barracks improved the conditions of segregated schools throughout the South, and Mary was fortunate to receive one, allowing her growing school to accommodate more students.
Yeah. So, later years, things began to get better for some. And then the Board of Education, this come about after World War II. World War II was over, and they was tearing down these army barracks that they was using, and they was donated to these schools. They would tear those barracks down and they would transport them to different areas. And they began to build these barracks, school out of the barracks, building them.
And back in those days, you know, all grades were in one room. They got the barracks and brought them to that site where the little brown schoolhouse was. The men of the community, they used these river rocks to build up high to set these barracks on high enough so that on
days, we could play, I mean, almost like a 5-foot boy could play under there and be sheltered from the rain or the sun. And she had the men to join these barracks together so you could go from the fifth one to always to the first one by never going outside. You still had doors on the side of these that you could go out to the bathroom in different places. They were also joined door to door, could walk straight through from barrack 5 to barrack 1. Different ones represented different classes.
This was the school consisted of the original Mary Johnson High School building, the one-room building, Army Barracks. You had a big section with a T for the middle school. And then you had two additional buildings, primary and middle schools. And there was a two-room building for home economics and English. That was the beginning of high school for blacks in Hurd County. The principal didn't even have an office. At the time, his office was his car. He would drive up. And that was what we had. And this is before 1954 when they built the school that you are familiar with. Prior to that, you didn't have that. The building I worked in was the original building that Mrs. Mary Johnson built. I would go to school. I would have to start a fire in the potbelly heater to heat up the room. Yeah. And the students would come. And that's what you had. You did not have these modern facilities that y'all are familiar with. Because y'all think that it's been that way all the time. So I have lived from President Hoover through Obama. So I've lived through a revolution.
The dedication and sacrifice that it took Mary to build her school left her with no tolerance for students she perceived were not taking full advantage of the opportunity that she had struggled to provide them.
Well, she was a very stern person, and she wanted you to learn in her class. And if you was not paying attention, she had the technique of throwing a paddle at you. Not really at you, but
yes.
in that direction where the noise was coming from.
She was a Mary Johnson. That's right. She bad at me years.
Well, she is.
she was holy. Didn't cross her either. She stood firm in what she believed. She was very generous and very strict. Boy, I tell you, you didn't play mess around with her. She would tear you up.
Well, she was very firm. If she says something to you one time, next time, boot will come in at you. And so she just very fine. She would put across her and said, "Don't move." And she patted there.
She kept me behind my ear and put me down the hall, making me mine, you know, the old kind of thing. You know, I won't go in detail about them because, you know, they'll think I was pretty bad back in the day. When you were doing something really wrong, she would sit you down and give you a good lecture and a good talking to. I've seen her sit down many people and she gave them a good talking to. And I would one up, you know, and she gave me a good talking to. And she didn't mind coming to your house in the evening and talking to your parents. They don't won't come to some people's houses, they won't go. Mary Hines Johnson will go to your house, talk to your mother and father, and tell them how you've been acting, what you need to do to improve your grades, what you need to do to just improve being a good student?
Well, back in those days, every adult could discipline a child. And when he went home, he got reinforcement from his parents. But now, they have too many lawyers, because the minute you cross a student or parent, they want to sue you. And so now people are reluctant to even correct a child who was acting out in the public. She believed in discipline. She was the type of person who could go into the boys' restrooms and get them to do what was right. And I think all of them knew of her reputation, so they did not cross Ms. Mary Johnson. You acted right in her presence.
1954. In Brown versus Board of Education, the Supreme Court's unanimous decision overturns Plessy and declares that separate schools are inherently unequal. The court rules that the federal government is under the same duty as the states to desegregate. 1955. The Supreme Court orders lower courts to require desegregation with all deliberate speed. Between 1955 and 1960, federal judges hold more than 200 school desegregation hearings.
For the integration, shit bad. But when the integration came about in the county, there was a lot of concern about the schools and what to do, how they're going to try to fix the thing so that, and they wanted to come up with a plan somehow that they wanted to sort of keep us still separated, but they weren't able to do that. They couldn't do it. They tried everything to try to do that, but weren't able to do it. But so when they finally come up with, there's no way. There gotta be. We got to. We're gonna get be funded by this, the government, the state. For the money, and the city weren't able to, kind of weren't able to fund the school themselves, so they had to go along with it.
Now I think they integrated the wrong way. Instead of starting at the high school, they should have started with teachers, so they have somebody in those schools, so when the students go, they'd have somebody they could identify with. But in many cases, they started with the students, putting them in a hostile environment with nowhere to go for refuge. That's my criticism of the way integration started in some places. I had an opportunity in 1960-61 to go to what you call a guidance institute at Atlanta University. And the professor said, "I mean, I want you when you finish." I said, "I do not care. I'm going." And I went. The first half of my institute was assigned at David T. Howard High School in Atlanta. And I was supposed to be counseling students with an IQ of 120 or better. So one of the girls that I was the counseling, she was going to be valedictorian, but they wanted her to go to the white school the next year. And it made her sick. And so when I was practicing counseling, she would tell me about her friend. And she was talking about herself. And so the next session I had with her, I said, "Man, this friend you was telling me about, could that be me?" And all she could do is laugh. And so I told her, I said, "You don't have to go to another school next year. That's what you have counselors in the schools for." And so that girl became one of the three valedictorians at David T. Howard the next year. She went on to Marsh Brown College And she was a very successful person, but she was real, real anxious about integration.
I think it was a good thing because there were more opportunities for the kids, you know, and certain, the equipment and things that they had. And I think it was the first year that we integrated. We had a student that was very smart. His sister, Grady Woodruff and Will Arias, her brother was the valedictorian at the integrated school the first year he was there. With, you know, he was able to do that with, you know, the white students there. Out of the class that he graduated from, he was valedictorian. There were more opportunities for the kids to take part in the activities because they had football and they had the kids who were able to get some scholarships to go to college out from that. And they were in band and, you know, this sort of thing that they had. So I think it was a good thing.
Integration set in motion the closing of smaller schools that were often essential to the education of blacks during segregation. These schools were consolidated and moved to locations suitable to both the black and the white student populations. The original Mary Johnson School suffered a similar fate. However, the building of a new brick school at that time was seen as an improvement.
Everybody was bussed in to that one place. It was a wonderful day for, as you would say, the colored children and parents of Heard County.
With integration came teacher certification. After years of heading her own school, Mary Hines Johnson found herself in the position of having to further her own education to teach at the school that carried her name.
But see, what happened? She didn't have the license to continue to teach in her kind or any other kind. See, at that time, most of our black teachers and most of our white teachers, they didn't have a degree. I remember when I was at Davis Junior High School, it went into the ninth grade. And then after the ninth grade, you went for your education. You either went to Newnham, LaGrange, or Carrollton. And when you graduated from the ninth grade, you could teach in the county. You could teach. You go before the board of education, they had a little, get a little test, you pass that little, then you could teach.
And during her time, that was when they first began to license teachers, and she went back to school at Fort Valley, I understand, and got her license. A lot of changes occurred during that time. They began to want more teachers to have their BS degree.
I know that during that time, many of the black teachers would go to what was called Saturday schools, and down at, I mean, they would go, when I was in college, they would come in from Saturday, you know, to upgrade their certificate or whatever they were working on. So I don't know what kind of certification she had, and at that time, I'm sure that the state was putting some kind of standards
or
something.
She was attending summer school down in Fort Valley. And some weekends she would ride down with my husband, come back up, because my husband was from Fort Valley. He's a VOAG teacher here for 30 some years. And he retired in 94. And in here he has a project named after him, Robert Kennedy Holmes. And there's a water plant down the street named after him. He was well known here in a lot of organizations.
The evolutionary stage from the beginning, if you go all the way back to 1635, the Boston Latin Grammar Schools, then the legislation to start public schools, 1642 Massachusetts law, if you had gifted families, you had to provide a school, and then 1647 tax, and on down Horace Mann. But that was not for blacks. You had the dame schools, the pauper schools, that kind of stuff. But you had Anna T. Jeans. She had a fund that she started, the Jeans Schools, the Roosevelt Schools. Most of you can remember Ms. Mary Johnson School was built similar to a Roosevelt School, where you had two windows on one side and so forth, the one room building. Then she also started for the special subjects, art, music, and so forth. She had what we originally called Jeans Supervisor. They were the person who taught the special subjects. And we know them now as curriculum directors, but they were called Jeans Supervisor. And the transition of black schools, those Jeans Supervisor was equivalent to black superintendents of school, because they didn't want to be bothered with black people. So superintendents delegate that authority to the Jeans Supervisor, and they would keep the schools going as long as they didn't come directly to the superintendent. And so that's how most people remember black education back in the 20s and 30s. And it evolved in 1950. They passed the Minimum Foundation Program, which means that that's when they started standardizing schools, when they had so many days and different things that we know today, which would be standards.
In 1968, Mary's name was removed from the school. The brick school that was an offspring of the original wooden school she started in the 1940s. This devastated Mary and the community.
The name came about in the surrounding counties, states, all around the state, were doing primarily the same thing. didn't keep Mary Johnson name. So they come up with the name Heard Elementary. There wasn't a whole lot said about it at that time. Didn't anybody come out? Didn't nobody speak up at that time? It went on for years. Then people began to come out and begin to talk among themselves about it. It took the name of the school away. They didn't like it. But sometimes you wait too late to speak. And that's what happened. I believe if the people had got together at that particular time, that name never would have changed.
She was deeply crushed when I believe it was in 1968, the summer in May, they told her that, or they made the announcement that the school was going to be, the name was going to change. It would no longer be Mary Johnson, and it would be just the elementary school.
Most tragic thing after all of that was when I returned home from California to find out that this great woman legacy had been destroyed, and her name had been destroyed and taken away from all the work that she had done.
Well, I was young at the time, but I was told a lot of people were angry. A lot of people cried about it. And a lot of people voiced their opinion. but it fell on deaf ear, like I said a few minutes ago. And people just wouldn't, they weren't willing to listen to the black community, because they felt that they were acting in the best interest for us at that point in time. But it wasn't. When they took the name off the school, then it like took something from inside of us.
But when they first integrated and built the middle school, they took the name from the school. And I don't think Mary Hines Johnson ever got over that. I think she felt that she was being disrespected. And I spoke out and said, it's not fair to me. Because when I refer to the school that I worked at, I can't say Mary Johnson, or former Mary Johnson. That's disrespect for everybody when you do things that way.
When the school, when they announced that the school would close, I think your Uncle Ted was the last or next to the last graduating class. The announcement was made in May. And when the school season started back, this time it was August or late September. Anyway, Grandma had a stroke and died.
Mary Hines Johnson died on September 18th, 1969. An educational pioneer had gone as far as she could go within the community she served. They would have to go on without her.
When they took the name off of it, that kind of hurt me, Mary Johnson, you know. And that took a lot out of me. You know, like, it was in 1968 they took it off. And it shouldn't. In 1969, she died from a broken heart.
Well, Mrs. Johnson was funeralized at State Line Baptist Church. She asked me to, they asked me to be on the program. And so I spoke about Mrs. Mary Johnson, how she influenced me in making the decision as to taking a job at Mary Johnson High School.
Regardless what the future holds, Mary Hines Johnson should be remembered for the contributions she made to the education of blacks in Heard County.
I would like them to remember her dedication. She really stuck behind what she believed in, and she worked to get what she wanted done. She went after a project, she went after it and finished it. And today we don't have many people doing that. They don't finish. They start out, but they fall by the wayside.
A great lady that not only cared for her family, but cared for everybody else's family. A giant of a lady. A role model for any community. But I thank God she was in her county, in our community. She could have went anywhere and did anything she wanted to, but she settled here in her county. And I'm so glad she settled here in her county and did the thing that she did do, because the real book and the real story had not been told yet. But it will be told. And I think someday someone's gonna come to Heard County like Tyler Perry. They're gonna do a movie about this city and this county. And the truth will be told, and Mary Hines Johnson will go in a proper place. They grew up in life where it needs to be. That's what I think. If I got anything to do with it, and if I can say anything about it, then it will be. Because she did a lot of great things for a whole lot of people.
I would like for Mary Hines Johnson to be remembered as a great woman who was determined to teach her children how to read and write, to the point that she would even give of herself and her time, and sometimes probably to beg to get help to do these things, and she did it. And all of these things should not be forgotten. We don't forget other great people. We don't forget
Dr. Martin Luther King. I don't think he will ever be forgotten. I don't. In years and years into eternity, Mary shouldn't be either. Two of my fictional novels that I have written, the first one is Exit, and the second one, Breaking the Chain. This is the newest one that's just coming out. And I'm very proud of. And I'm very proud because if Mary Hines Johnson didn't start a school to teach people, teach us, I probably wouldn't be able to read and write, to write these novels. So I owe her gratitude for that.
Well, she has to be remembered as a pioneer in black education for Hurd County. She would have to be remembered that way, because she was the one that had that interest and she worked hard to make it a reality. That's what Miss Mary Johnson did.
Nearly 30 years after the school name change and Mary's death, her great-niece, Frankie Berry Wise, petitioned the Hurd County Board of Education to dedicate the media center in Mary's honor. It was a dire time for Mary's family, who feared that if something was not done, Mary's legacy would soon be forgotten.
Quickly, that came from your mother and Michelle. They put that together because, see, nothing was there representing Grandma.
Well, we first started writing letters asking that the name of the school be changed back to Mary Hines Johnson. So that didn't work. We went to the superintendent and the board, and it was no. No, it's just on deaf ears, no. So we asked, could we at least have a room in her name? So they did let us name the media center, the Mary Hines Johnson Media Center. The artist Ronald McDowell painted a portrait of her, and we hung it in this room. So the younger children can hopefully ask, who is this black woman? And maybe they would give some history of her. And that would keep her alive in the hearts of the younger people.
When you think about a pioneer like Mary Hines Johnson, one that was ahead of her time and a trailblazer for education, it was only befitting to do some form of dedication to her. And after much brainstorming with my mom, Frankie Wise, of Mary Hines Johnson, we decided to move ahead with the school media center name in her honor. And so during this time, it actually became a reality. We actually did the dedication of the school on February the 19th, 1993. And what's so remarkable is now it represents over 20 years that it was renamed in her honor. And I'm just proud not only to be her great-great niece and an integral part of her family, but to have served as mistress of ceremony for this most historical and landmark event.
We had a good representation there that night, and the I think the assistant superintendent spoke that night, and my father, and Frankie and Michelle. And they might have had some people from the community, but that it was, you know, very nice that they pulled this off.
Years after the media center dedication, the Hurd County Board of Education tore down Mary Johnson's school. With its demolition, the last remnant of the educational institution she donated her $28 salary to start was destroyed.
Well, we didn't want it tore down, but we didn't have any recourse because it was owned by the Board of Education. And nobody came to back us or to say anything or to go against it. And I understand that after the Board of Education sold it to the Hurd County Development Authority. So that was it.
It was a real emotional thing to a whole lot of people in this community, especially to the black community, because we had strong ties to that school. It really hurt. Matter of fact, a young lady by the name of Miss Zola Ransby and a guy by the name of Willie Nelson in the community and quite a few other people went up to the school board, including myself and my wife, Miss Sarah Alvin, went up to the school board to speak to the Board of Education about it. School superintendent Benja Height at the time. We asked him, stood up before the board and asked him not to tear the school down, asked him to change and put that name back on the school back when it was still standing. But no prevail, they did not listen. You know, they turned a deaf ear to that. Not speak negative about it, but they had more better plan. Like nothing is down now. It's just a level ground for tall grass room. Shouldn't be like that. That school should have stood. It should have been a boy and girl club up there, out there. That would have helped the whole truth about Mary Hines Johnson.
And it's a lot of disrespect when you say anything that has been black is no longer good. That seemed to be what they're saying when they change names or take names away and stop using facilities that was once black. See, their codes in the numbers. I can tell what school by just seeing the number in the book. That this was a black school, this is a white school. All those things are coded, and blacks don't know why, but they're that way. So I learned a lot of things just from figuring out what was going on, looking at records.
If I had to try to word it out, I would say, when she built that school, she was building that school to educate a lot of people that probably wouldn't have gotten the education. And she was doing something for all those little children, boys and girls, who she trained herself. Those were my children. I mean, you know, she found some people go out and adopt kids and all. She adopted this whole county, this whole community. Those were her children. And when they tore that school down, they ripped her heart out. What they did without knowing it. They didn't know really what they did to her. But they did something real rude and rude, you know, that's the way I see it, you know. They hurt her so bad. It's like, man, they went and tore me your house down, tore my house down. We got home, the house tore down, we would feel bad.
First, when they decided to build a new school, it was left standing there. And we asked my oldest daughter, Michelle, and I asked, could we have the plaque out of the school? And they said, no. No, it belongs to the school. We cannot even have that. Even if we are relatives of this lady, they said no. And then one day I was visiting my mother, and the school was almost down. Matter of fact, they were just bulldozing some boulders away. And that was a shock. They didn't use the school for anything. They also couldn't, no activities, no club for children. They just tore it down to the ground. It's as if they were saying, I want to get rid of everything that Stuart, Mary Johnson stood for.
With the urging of many in the community, a street was dedicated in Mary's honor.
Well, yeah, it's the game. Because I was sitting at the table that night when it came up. At the table, or sit home. And matter of fact, I made the motion to put that name on the street. And I had a good friend of mine, Mr. Rock McLean, second. Which he was a great man now in our community. He's just counted that I can depend on. And that night he gave, and I made that motion, second. That was a great thing. I felt so good that night, knowing her name was gonna be on that street.
You know my soul back in one.
As I sat at my great uncle Cleveland Cafe on the corner of the streets where my mother's family name and Mary Johnson's name cross, I reflected on what Councilman Allman said about my uncle, Mary, and the significance of this place.
He was a father figure. Your uncle, I call him Mr. Cleveland. He taught a lot of young boys in Harry County how to do a lot of great things. You know, it really cafe hold a lot of weight in the community, you know. That was an education place, and they married Hines Johnson too. She went in that place and taught to a whole lot of people too. It's the next thing to the schoolhouse, I guess, we can call a place to go, a home place.
When I was leaving Franklin, I felt sorrow for my great-great-aunt, Mary Hines Johnson. Throughout Heard County, I only found 8 things that stood as a small symbol of the work this educational trailblazer did for the community she once loved and served. The Ebenezer Church, where it all began. The place where Mary would walk to the fork of the road and meet mothers who entrusted their children to her. The place she had just left when a storm drove her under a bridge, where she prayed for her school. The site where her original wood school and army barracks once stood, where Mary donated her paycheck of $28 a month to Bill. The site where the colored children of Franklin finally had a place to learn during segregation. The rusty handrails, cement slabs, and bent signs that whispered the tale of a brick school that once occupied these grounds. The place that was pivotal in securing equal access to education for Black children after integration, while also leading to the removal of Mary's name from her own school. The site where my mother and sister petitioned to have the media center dedicated to Mary nearly 30 years later. A street sign that bears Mary Johnson's name. A street where among the many who did not know her, I found a few, like me, who had heard a little about her legacy. A photograph of Mary Johnson's original school hanging on the wall of a back room in the town's community center. A 2-page article in a book inside the old jail that now serves as a museum. An article that summed up Mary's contribution to education in Heard County within 8 paragraphs. The memories and the admiration that lives in the hearts of the people who once knew, worked for, were taught by, and just sincerely loved Mary. And the final resting place of my great-great-aunt, Mary Hines Johnson, where the leaves almost hid the inscription "Mother" on her gravestone. The place that for the first time I realized that we shared the same birth date, March 23rd. The resting place within the community that Mary served, educated, and inspired. Mary Hines Johnson, an educator, a pioneer, a woman who had a vision and did not stop until it became a reality.
I don't think if something is not changed, if something is not put in her name, even in that town, that in the next 10 or 15 years, there may not be anyone that knows who is Mary Hines Johnson.
Thank you.